I just want to say my name is Steve Bakken, and I am here in no official capacity with the city of Bismarck whatsoever. Nor was I outside. I commend you guys for speaking up and starting the conversation. I am a firm supporter of the Second Amendment. I am a firm supporter of the Constitution. I am a firm supporter of the First Amendment. Voices are where solutions come from. Everybody needs to come to the table and start the discussion. And one of the big things I really, really firmly believe is we do have a mental health problem. We have a bullying problem. We have a societal problem. We have lack of accountability within our society. These discussions is how we get back on track. So I commend you for coming to speak. I'm a little disappointed is that you didn't reach out to me, because I would love to have had some conversations with you outside of this room, or out in the open as well. Not behind closed doors, but going a little bit further from the perspective of the mental health issues, the bullying issues, what do you need? I mean, what do you need as far as... You can come up and speak on this microphone. I would love to hear your point of view as well.
One thing before we start, I would like to remind you, after the panel is over, they are always open to talk to anybody in the audience. So, no problem.
So, okay, so in regards to the mental health issue and the gun violence issue, I always pitch it to people as it's a Venn diagram where the mental health issue is over here and the gun violence issue is over here. If you solve one, there's still a whole lot for the other one. They don't really correlate in regards to like the way that the media tries to spin it, where they're like, oh, these mentally ill people are the reason all this violence is happening. That's not the case. There's mentally ill people all over the world that do not create the same violence that we create here in America. Secondly, we don't go town to town to meet with legislative people. We try to meet with the people of the area. I don't mean this in any offense to you, but we always push for policy, not people. And when we meet with lawmakers, it's usually because their offices are reaching out to us, and I don't believe your office did. And in regards to what you can really do to stand up for the Constitution is fight for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness of all the people in North Dakota or in your city of Bismarck, and try to fund things that actually bring the community together. Your name was used to get attention to that protest. When your name's a big font for something, usually you're the draw, and your name was a pretty big font. We didn't use your name, and we got a good amount of people in here to have a really good conversation. From the bottom of my heart, I really hope that being in this room today has educated you about some of the key issues that plague not only this community, but communities around the country. That this is the death that we see every day is not the cost of freedom. We can have freedom and save lives too. So.
So, do you know how much funding Donald Trump cut from medical or mental health care spending just this year?
Nothing.
It's a bit over $20 million after speaking about it. That's why we need to have these discussions. It's great. As Matt said, it's a Venn diagram. One of the main policies that we push for is extreme risk protection orders, which make sure that people... Do you know what an extreme risk protection order is? Okay, good. Because there's a lot of people and politicians that don't even know what that is, and it's important that we just have these discussions. But essentially, if we're able, for anybody that doesn't know it, it makes it so that if you're a mentally unstable individual or a person that is a danger to your risk, a risk to yourself or others, you can have your guns taken away through due process, and that is part of the mental health aspect, so it can be challenged in court if you want your guns back. But that's one of the main things that we push for. They're called ERPO bills. I don't know if you guys have one in North Dakota. It's a very conservative state, so I don't think so. But that's one thing that you could push for, especially in your city of Bismarck, is help disarm domestic abusers, people with mental health issues, and people that are risking themselves or others, So create a bill for that. One of the other things. One of the other things that we actively advocate for, one of our policy points, is known as violence prevention programs. These are programs that don't even call for any form of even any reforms to gun legislation. And what these programs do in communities, for like really, really dangerous communities, is they'll go to places like the South Side of Chicago, or in places in New York, Los Angeles, and they've gone into over 100 communities across the country in the past 18 years. And what they do is they hire people that have gone through the system, like former people that were in gangs, and people that were formerly criminals, and people that have grown up in these communities, and unlike a lot of the police officers that are policing them, actually know what the issues are in their community and grew up there. And they speak to the people that, the 2 to 5% of people that commit the most violence. For example, it's typically males between the ages of 15 to 25. They sit down and talk with them, and they say, if you're doing this for economic reasons, we're here for you. We will provide you with any of the resources that you need so that you don't go out and have to go rob somebody to get, like, food or just clothes. Because a lot of the time, that's part of the reason why perpetrates these things. It's economic immobility by these people. And it's also a lack of family. Like, in a lot of places, for example, in Salinas, California, there's a lot of, it's not a drug issue, and it's not an issue of, like, people just going out and, like, needing to make money. It's the fact that a lot of families, they have a lot of gangs there, because a lot of families there are immigrant families that work a lot on farms, and they need to work 3 to 4 jobs oftentimes to live that American dream. And when those families aren't around because they're fighting so hard for their kids, they go out and find family in the form of gangs. Meanwhile in Oakland, California, there's a lot of, because it's kind of a port city, there's a lot of drug violence that goes on there, and there's a lot of turf wars. What you can do is you can create a violence prevention program in the city of Bismarck that costs $2 million a year, but saves billions down the line. For example, in Florida, it costs taxpayers $20 billion a year to treat gunshot wounds. These programs are able to lower the rates of violent crime by 40 to 70% in most areas, even without any call to gun control or anything like that, and are able to save a lot of lives and billions of dollars at the end of the day. So that's what you can do as a local elected official, and listen to your constituents. So thank you for being here.